So, okay, as you can see, today we will start with the histological structure of the gastrointestinal tract, and two lectures it includes. So today we will speak about the histology of the esophagus and the stomach. Yes, and then in the next lecture on Thursday we will continue with the histology of the intestines. So you can see now a schematic drawing of the esophagus, which represents very well the main layers of the alimentary canal. Because in the entire alimentary canal, we will see four layers. The innermost one is called mucosa. As you can see, it is composed of altogether three layers. The innermost layer is always an epithelial layer called epithelial mucosae, and then you will have a connective tissue layer. This is the lamina propria. This is always a loose connective tissue, a cell-rich type of loose connective tissue here. Then you will have a third layer of the mucosa. It is called lamina muscularis mucosae, and it is composed of longitudinally arranged smooth muscle cells. And this is a special layer of the mucosa, which is only found in the alimentary canal. Yes, so in the alimentary canal, the mucosa comprises of these three layers. Then, under the mucosa, we will have again loose connective tissue. It's called submucosa. And as you can see, it also contains a nerve plexus. It is called Meissner plexus or submucosa plexus. We will speak about it today. Then the next layer is a muscle layer called muscularis. It can be divided in two layers, as you can see it also here, into an inner circular and an outer longitudinal layer. And as you can see, the circular layer appears in a cross section the smooth muscle cells appears in a cross section in longitudinal cut. But if you have a longitudinal section, you can see it in this area, the circular layer occurs in cross section. So this muscle layer can also help you to say whether you have a cross section or a longitudinal section of the gut wall. Yes, and the outer longitudinal layer appears in a cross section if you have a cross section of the gut wall. And in a longitudinal section, you will see the smooth muscle cells longitudinally arranged. Yes, so this is the muscle layer. And as you can see, between the two layers, we have another nerve plexus. It is called myenteric plexus or Auerbach's plexus. It is marked in yellow here. And we have an outermost layer. It can be different. It can be called serosa. And it means that we have a mesothelium in this case. But we only have a serosa if the organ is covered by the peritoneum. If it is not, then we have a connective tissue layer called adventitia, which is a loose connective tissue layer. So it can be different, the outermost layer. In this case, you have here a serosa. You can see here serosa because this picture shows the abdominal part of the esophagus. You can see here the diaphragm, and the abdominal part of the esophagus has a peritoneal covering. But let's continue with a histological slide. On the right side, you can see a hematoxylin eosin stained slide from the esophagus. And this is a slide which you have already seen last semester, as we learned the epithelium, the epithelial tissue, and as we learned the stratified non-keratinized squamous epithelium, we had this slide. So you can see the slide again, and here you can see this epithelium I mentioned. I want to emphasize that here we have lots of connective tissue papilla, which are important in the blood supply of the epithelium and for the mechanical stability between the connective tissue layer and the epithelium. And as you can see, the cells are quite pale because we have a thick epithelium here, and the thickness could be about 500 micrometers. And in this case, the epithelial cells contain lots of glycogen, yes, because they have to store these nutrients, because the blood supply occurs through diffusion, and the diffusion is a slow process. That's why the cells have to store these nutrients like glycogen or lipids, and they are not stained now with hematoxylin everything. Okay, so the next layer under the epithelium, you can see it here, this is this loose connective tissue, yes, which can contain lots of connective tissue cells, both mobile or fixed cells. And here you can see a lymphatic follicle. It can also occur in this tissue, and also vessels and nerves. And here at the bottom, you can see this lamina muscularis mucosae. And now you can see the smooth muscle cells in the longitudinal cut, because we have a longitudinal section now from the esophagus. And I want to highlight these folds you can see on the surface are not due to this muscle layer. This muscle layer, the function of this muscle layer is to help the veins and lymphatic vessels to empty their content, so it moves actually the mucosa only, this muscle layer. So the next slide is stained by PASH reaction, so PASH and hematoxylin staining. Not an exam slide, but I want to show you here, which I actually mentioned, that the epithelial cells contain lots of glycogen, which is now stained with PASH, yes? But I want to point out that also in the vagina, we will see the epithelial, pale epithelial cells with hematoxylin eosin. So please do not mix up the two slides with each other. In the vagina, the cells will be much lighter with hematoxylin eosin than here. And then you can see here also the basal membrane, which is also PASH positive. And then it should be here, the lamina tropia, and the muscularis mucosae appears here in cross-section, because now we have a cross-section of the esophagus. And the submucosa contains lots of glands. These are the so-called esophageal glands, mainly mucose glands. They are, you can see the PASH positivity also in this case. But these glands are not found in the entire length of the esophagus, only in the upper and in the lower part of the organ. The next slide shows the muscle layer of the esophagus. On the top, you have the inner circular layer, and here the outer longitudinal layer. And as you can see now, appear the muscle cells of the longitudinal layer in longitudinal cut. So this is again a longitudinal section of the esophagus. So this is smooth muscle. Yes, both the inner and the outer muscle layer. Only in the upper part of the esophagus we can have some striated muscles. This is actually a continuation of the pharyngeal muscles. And at the border of the pharynx and the esophagus, we can we have a so-called pharyngeal esophageal sphincter muscle. So this is a live thickening of the muscle layer. And at the end of the esophagus, so in the cardia, we have only a physiological sphincter muscle. So it means that the muscles can show a tonic contraction, but in anatomical sense, we do not have a sphincter muscle. What I want to emphasize here, that between the two layers, we have neurons. Yes, these neurons are here enlarged. So these are parts of this mesenteric plexus, Auerbach's plexus. This is a network of neurons, actually. I will speak about it here in the next slide. Yes, about this nerve plexus we have in the entire alimentary canal, also in the esophagus. So we have two plexus. One of them is found in the mucosa, in the submucosa. This is the Meissner plexus or submucosa plexus, and the other one is located between the two muscle layers. This is the mesenteric or Auerbach's plexus. And you will also have in the practice a histological slide which we show this plexus with a special staining method, and it will be a preparation where you will see the nerve cells in an upper view, so in a bird's eye view, and you will see then these nerve cells, also the morphology of the nerve cells. The nerve cells are here, the neurons are here, multipolar, so they have lots of dendrites. And naturally, they also have an axon, and they form a really network in the entire alimentary canal. So this plexus contains more than 100 million neurons. So it's five times more than the number of the neurons in the spinal cord. So this is a huge nerve plexus in the alimentary canal. It can be also called brain of the alimentary canal. Here you can see a schematic drawing how it works. Here at the bottom you can see the epithelium schematically. This is the muscularis mucosae. So this layer corresponds to the submucosa. So these are the neurons schematically of the submucosa plexus, and these are the two muscle layers. So inner circular, outer longitudinal layer, and this is the mesenteric plexus now between the two muscle layers. And as you can see, functionally, most of the neurons are visceromotor neurons. That means that they can influence the contractions of the muscle layers. You can see here, for example, how a neuron terminates at a smooth muscle cell here, and the other muscle layer can also terminate nerve cells. But we also have sensory neurons and interneurons. Here you can see some examples also for these types of neurons. And the function of this plexus is actually to coordinate the peristaltic movements of the muscle layers. So it is what actually the mesenteric plexus is responsible for. The submucosa plexus regulates mainly the secretory activity of glands, yes, or in both cases the smooth muscles of the vessels are controlled by these neurons. So this plexus can actually function without the central nervous system as well. So this is an autonomic plexus, but it will be influenced by the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system as well. So similarly to the sinus node of the heart, yes. So it can contract automatically as well, but as you can see also here, sympathetic fibers coming from the sympathetic trunk or prevertebral ganglia, so the axons of this nervous system terminates also on these neurons. Or parasympathetic fibers coming with the vagus nerve can also influence these neurons. Yes, so this is a autonomic plexus, but the central nervous system regulates also the activity of these neurons. And the neurotransmitters are mainly not the conventional neurotransmitters like acetylcholine or noradrenaline or epinephrine, but mainly we have inhibitory neurotransmitters like nitric oxide or vasoactive intestinal peptide. So mostly we have an inhibitory effect. In this picture, you can also see here some smooth muscle cells in red, and in yellow you can see axons of neurons of this nerve plexus, and in green you can see a so-called interstitial cell of Cajal. These cells are also involved in regulation of peristaltic movements. They can actually generate also peristaltic movements, as you can see here in the stomach, for example, three slow waves in a minute. So they are like pacemakers, or they can also mediate the inputs of neurons to the smooth muscle cells. And these are actually also smooth muscle cells, but modified smooth muscle cells, so similarly to the cells of the sinus node. And clinically they are important because if they are not present, the contractions of the smooth muscle cells can interrupt it, and it can lead to functional GI disorders. For example, you have probably heard about the irritable bowel syndrome, and in the background it can be the loss of these interstitial cells, and also tumors can originate from these cells. Some other clinical aspects I want to emphasize, for example, the so-called achalasia. This is a condition when the muscles of the cardia, so as you can see in the picture, that's the esophagus, and here should be the border between the esophagus and the stomach, and you can see contraction of the cells here, so the food cannot enter the stomach, that's why. And why? Because here we have a lack of these neurons. Of the mesenteric plexus, lack of the inhibitory neurons, and that's why the smooth muscle cells cannot relax, and the tonic contraction inhibits the food enter the stomach. Or the same condition we can have in the rectum or in the sigmoid colon, as you can see it here. And then the feces cannot pass through these parts of the gut, and above the occlusion, the guts are pathologically enlarged. This is called Hirschsprung's disease or megacolon congenitum. About this disease, I will also speak next time when we will speak about the histology of the intestines. But some words about the submucosa of the esophagus, also some clinical aspects. You can see here two endoscopic pictures showing very pathologically enlarged veins or arteriovenous anastomosis, or venous anastomosis in the submucosa, which can be seen in case of the liver cirrhosis. You have probably heard about it, that the alcohol damage can damage the liver, and then it leads to the so-called portal hypertension, because the liver because the blood cannot pass through the liver in this case, and the blood tries to escape in another direction, for example, in the direction of the esophageal veins, which get enlarged in this case. And it's very it's a very dangerous condition because very strong bleedings can start from these enlarged veins. These are called esophageal varices, and it can lead to death. About the portal hypertension, you will learn in anatomy in details. But now let's continue with the stomach. You can see that the esophagus continues in the stomach. The body was called cardia. And as you can see in this schematic picture, in the stomach we will have the same layers we have already mentioned. So we have the mucosa with the epithelium, lamina propria, and a muscular layer of the mucosa. You can see it already that the epithelium will show invaginations. Lots of invaginations. They will be the so-called gastric pits, which are characteristic for the entire stomach. And the other thing which is visible, that the lamina propria contains lots of glands. These are the glandular gastrices, or the glands of the stomach. In the entire stomach we will have these glands. These are tubular glands, which occupy actually the entire lamina propria. Then submucosa, and then we have the muscle layer, and here we have an extra layer. So we have an outer longitudinal and an inner circular layer, but we also have an innermost layer where the muscle cells form a network. Yes, so this is not, this, it won't be so well visible in our slides, but theoretically you have to know about this third layer. And then the outermost layer is called serosa in this case, because the stomach is covered completely by the peritoneum. So you can see here the mesothelial cells, tunica serosa. Hematoxylin eosin. So here you can see a small magnification of the stomach, and this is the mucosa in the upper part of the picture, and you can also see here these epithelial invaginations and the lamina propria with lots of glands. We will speak about the mucosa in details right now. Muscularis mucosae, you can see here. Then this lighter layer is the submucosa, which also contains, like always, vessels, nerves, and nerve plexus. And here the muscle layer. And the serosa is not visible here, but with hematoxylin eosin, could also see this simple squamous epithelium, so this mesothelium. So this is the outermost layer. But let's continue with the mucosa a little bit in details. And here on the left, you can see now a pus hematoxylin stain slide, which shows the epithelium and the lamina propria. And on the right, you can see a schematic drawing of this area. So what are the characteristics of the mucosa? At first, you can see here the so-called gastric pits. So these are, as I mentioned, invaginations of the epithelium. So these are lined by the surface epithelium. And as you can see, the surface epithelium is strongly pus positive. Each cell of the epithelium is pus positive because the epithelium is composed of the so-called mucous surface cells. These are actually columnar cells, so the surface epithelium is a simple columnar epithelium, as you can see also here in this schematic drawing, and also here with pus. And as you can see, all of the cells are secretory active. And see, in all the cells we have secretory vesicles filled with mucus, and the mucus is strongly pus positive. So this is very characteristic for the entire stomach. So simple columnar epithelium with mucous surface cells. And as you can see, the mucus appears also inside of these pits. Then the other characteristic of the entire stomach is that the entire lamina propria contains glands. Morphologically, the glands are tubular glands. They can be simple or ramified like here, which always open into a gastric pit. And as you can see, the glands reach as far as the muscularis mucosa. And they are very closely packed. So you will see that the entire lamina propria is occupied actually, so the lower part of the lamina propria is occupied by these glands. And they can be lined by different cells, but it will vary in the different parts of the stomach. Here you can see scanning electron micrographs which show these gastric pits. So these are also called foveoli, gastrici in Latin. And in this picture, in the right lower corner, you can also see the mucus film. Yeah, so I also want to emphasize this mucus film, which is produced by these surface mucus cells, epithelial cells. And the mucus have a very important protective function. As you can see, it's quite thick, so about 200 micrometers is the thickness of this mucus film. And it protects the stomach, the mucosa of the stomach, against the gastric acid and against these aggressive enzymes like the pepsin. And this mucus film contains mainly so-called mucins. These are glycoproteins. These form the most important diffusion barrier for the pepsin, but it also contains bicarbonate, which is the barrier against the hydrochloric acid, and also some phospholipids. So the entire surface is covered by this mucus film, but as you can see, the histological structure of the mucosa can vary according to the parts of the stomach. We will have also slides from each region. And as you can see in the cardia, for example, this schematic drawing shows here the cardia. So here the gastric pits will be relatively deep, so not as deep as, for example, in the pyloric part. They will occupy only the upper third of the mucosa, and the lower two thirds are occupied by the cardiac glands. And here the glands are quite branched and coiled. That's why we will see lots of cross sections of the glands in this area. And these glands will produce mainly mucins, the mucus. In the next part of the stomach, so in the gastric fundus and the corpus, we will have also gastric pits, but they will occupy only the one, so the upper quarter of the mucosa. And in the lower part of the mucosa, we will have very closely packed long tubular glands, which will be lined by different cell types. And in the last part of the stomach, in the so-called pyloric part, we will have the deepest pits. They will occupy the upper half of the mucosa, and in the lower half of the mucosa, we will also have glands, the so-called pylori glands, but they will produce again only mucus, similarly to the cardiac part. And you will see that the glands will also here appear in cross sections, because here the glands are very coiled because they do not have so many place as, for example, in the fundus part. So how these parts of the stomach appear in our slides. So cardia, you will have both a hematoxylin eosin and the pus hematoxylin stain slide. And this slide you will recognize very easily because you will have an epithelial transition here. And this transition will be a sharp transition. So it means that the epithelium of the esophagus changes into this stomach epithelium, so into this simple columnar epithelium, which will be strongly pus positive. And but if you have a look at the entire mucosa, you will also see naturally the gastric pits in the stomach part of the cardia, and you will see that that these pits are lined by the surface epithelium, and they will be strong pus positive, the epithelial cells. And in the lower part of the mucosa, you will see the cardiac glands. They can appear, as I mentioned, often in cross sections, but they will be lined practically by mucous cells, which produce a relatively invasive mucus. Yes, so the mucus can be different from the surface epithelial cells. So there will be a viscous mucus produced, and from the glands, the mucus produced by the glands is relatively inviscid. And this mucus is mainly produced if we are eating, and the glands are lined so mainly by these mucous cells, but some endocrine cells and some undifferentiated cells also found in the wall of the glands, but you do not have to recognize these two cell types, but the mucous cells will be strongly pus positive. The mucus has an important function. It will protect the cardia and also the lower part of the esophagus against the hydrochloric acid and the enzymes produced in the corpus and the fundus part of the stomach. So how does it look like, the corpus and fundus parts of the stomach? You can see a schematic drawing about this part. The epithelium is the same, so I won't speak about the epithelium, but about the glands I want to speak in details, because as you can see, the glands are lined by different cell types, and they occur in different parts of the glands. The glands can be, so in case of the glands, we distinguish a basal part of the glands, a neck part, and the neck part of the glands, and the so-called isthmus part, which could be the transition between the gland and the foveola and the gastric pit. And as you can see, that the basal part of the glands is mainly lined by the so-called chief cells, and these are the cells which produce the pepsinogen. The pepsinogen is the premature form of the pepsin. This is the enzyme which breaks down the proteins. Or we can also find some endocrine cells in the basal part, but you do not have to recognize these cells, but you have to say some examples for hormones which are produced by these cells. Parietal cells are the largest cells, which can occur both in the basal and in the neck part, so everywhere actually in the glands. And these are the cells which are responsible for production of the gastric acid and the so-called intrinsic factor. This intrinsic factor is a glycoprotein which is responsible for the resorption of the vitamin B12, which is resorbed not in the stomach but later in the intestines. But without this factor, it is not possible, and if you do not have this factor, you will have an anemia. That's why, because vitamin B12 is involved in the hematopoiesis. Mucous neck cells are practically found in the neck part of the glands. They produce again an inviscid mucus. And the fifth cell type is called reserve cells. They are found in the isthmus part, so at the transition, and from these undifferentiated cells, both the surface epithelium and the glands are actually formed. Yes, so these are the five cell types which can occur in the glands, but in our slides, you only have to recognize the mucous cells, the parietal cells, and the chief cells. I will also show it how they look like in our slides. But at first, some schematic drawing. So here you can see a chief cell, and you can see that in the apical part of the cytoplasm, you have lots of secretory granules, which are filled with this pepsinogen mainly, but also some amounts of lipase are found in these granules. And these are proteins, so enzymes, proteins, and that's why the cell contains lots of rough endoplasmic reticulum found mainly in the basal part of the cell. And that's why the cells will be strongly basophilic. Here on the right side, you can see schematically an endocrine cell, which contains also secretory granules, but not in the apical part, but mainly in the basal part of the cell, because these cells produce hormones, and hormones will be emptied into the bloodstream, released in the bloodstream. And so please look at some examples for hormones. Yes, in details, you will learn about it in physiology, but some examples you should also know for the histology exam. And parietal cells, you can see here, and also you can see these cells now in a histological slide with hematoxylin eosin stained, and you will see that these cells will be strongly eosinophilic, and these are the largest cells, as you can see. Why are the cells eosinophilic? It has more reasons. For example, as you can see here, the cells show lots of intracellular canaliculi, which contain lots of microvilli. So you have a very huge surface toward the lumen. So the lumen should be here in the upper part. Because this enzyme, which is responsible for the hydrochloric acid release, is located in the cell membrane, and it requires a very large surface. Or we also have lots of so-called tubular vesicular, or lots of reserve membranes which form an apical tubular vesicular system, and these membranes can be then involved into the into the membrane surface if it is needed. And they are also eosinophilic. And actually the most important structure which is responsible for the eosinophilic staining are the mitochondria. This iron pump requires lots of energy, and this energy is formed in this mitochondria. Yes, so that's why are the cells strongly eosinophilic. And this is physiology. I only want to emphasize that in the lumen of the stomach we have a pH 2, so it can only formed by this iron pump, which functions against a very strong concentration gradient. And these cells are mainly stimulated by hormones like gastrin or by parasympathetic fiber. Why do we need this acid in the stomach? For example, this is important for the activation of the pepsinogen. So without this acid, it is not possible. It has a strongly bactericid effect, and it's also involved in the protein denaturation. How does it look like, this part of the stomach? Here you can see on the left a pus stain slide and on the right a hematoxylin eosin stain slide. And in both cases, you can see that the gastric pits are not deep, actually. We mainly have glands in the lower fourth of the mucosa, and this part of the mucosa can further divide it actually in two parts, as you can see, mainly with hematoxylin eosin, because back part of the glands appears light, quite light, yes, because here the mucous neck cells predominate. And the basal part of the glands, and that's why the basal part of the mucosa appears quite basophilic, because here the chief cells predominate. Yes, so the mucosa can be actually divided in three parts. In the upper third, we have the gastric pits, which appears eosinophilic. Then you have a quite pale region in the middle part, and then a basophilic region. And if you enlarge the basal part, you will see lots of chief cells, which are, as I mentioned, strongly basophilic due to the rough endoplasmic reticulum, but you can also see the parietal cells here. And the endocrine cells are not visible. To show them, we should use special immunohistological staining methods. Or if you enlarge the neck part of the glands, and now I'm showing it with pus age, because pus shows very well the mucous neck cells. You can see the cells now in the middle part of the gland. And what I want to highlight is that the basal membrane will be also very well visible with pus staining, because it's pus positive. And as you can see, we actually cannot see the connective tissue of the lamina propria, because we have so many glands, so the glands are very closely packed, and actually the lamina propria doesn't is not visible, or no, barely visible. Okay, and very fast some words about the pyloric part of the stomach. So that's the last part of the stomach, and here you will have the deepest gastric pits. They occupy the upper half of the mucosa, and in the lower half you will have the pyloric glands, which appear very light again with hematoxylin eosin, because the glands are lined mainly by mucous cells again, so similarly to the cardiac glands. And we have some endocrine cells or undifferentiated cells as well, but no chief or parietal cells occur here. So chief cells and parietal cells are only found in the fundus or corpus part of the stomach. Yes, and with pus staining, you will also see it in the practice. Pus hematoxylin shows again very well the both the gastric pits and the glands, higher magnification as well. And maybe you have seen it that we have a difference in the color of the mucus seen in the epithelial cells and in the glands. The reason for this difference is that the composition of the mucin can be different. So we have lots of mucin molecules, and on the surface, so the mucin produced by the surface cells is more viscid, viscose, and that's why it appears darker than the mucins found in the glands. So that was this pyloric part, and just a picture about the so-called pylorus. Pylorus is actually the border between the stomach and the duodenum, and it contains the sphincter muscle, which is actually the thickening of the inner circular muscle, but this muscle is not visible in our slides. Yes, I'm only showing it. And if you are interested, you can also have a look at this pyloric stenosis, but it is anatomy, so I will continue to the next slide. And this is what I want to emphasize again, that in the stomach we have aggressive components like gastric acid and pepsin, and to protect the mucosa, the here listed protecting mechanisms are very important. And if this balance is destroyed, then it can lead to gastric ulceration. The gastric ulcer is one of the most common gastric diseases, and it can be caused either through an overproduction of gastric acid, or if the mucus production is decreased. Aspirin, for example, can cause this because it inhibits the synthesis of prostaglandin E2, which normally produces the mucin, or stimulates the mucus production. Or a bacterium called Helicobacter or Campylobacter pylori can also cause an ulceration, because this is a very aggressive bacterium. It can go into the depth of the mucosa and cause this ulcer. So that is one of the clinical aspects, but we can also have the gastroesophageal reflux disease. This is also quite common when the lower esophageal sphincter tone is decreased, and that's why the content of the secretion can flow back into the esophagus. And yes, these are the triggering factors, and it can cause erosions. So erosion means when only the epithelium is destroyed, but later it can cause deeper scars or narrowing of the lumen. And the so-called Barrett esophagus means that from this Barrett esophagus also a cancer can be developed. So you will learn about these diseases later in the clinical practice. And if you are and one more disease, the atrophic gastritis, I want to mention, because so that means that the glands disappear from the stomach, so mainly the parietal cells disappear. And if you remember, the parietal cells are involved in the resorption of vitamin B12 through this intrinsic factor. And if you do not have these cells, so the vitamin B12 cannot be absorbed, and then it can lead to a special type of anemia called pernicious anemia. And this is also a precancerosis. That means that if you will have a patient with the anemia, you have to go further and you have to look for a gastric cancer, for example. If you are interested in the composition of mucins, you can read also these two slides, but these won't be asked in the exam. Okay, so that was for today. Thank you for everyone. And next time we will continue with the histology of the alimentary, so with the histology of the intestines.